Hello, it's an honor to present in this workshop. I'm going to talk about continuous models of computation. Andras Karnai was always interested in continuous motives in the models of computation, such as Ehlenberg machines and more recently his own Euclidean automata, so I hope this would be of interest. Data flow matrix machines generalize neural networks. And this generalization is sufficiently powerful that you can write programs in the resulting formalism. But program is still determined as a matrix of numbers, just like for neural nets. And program can be transformed into any other program by continuously transforming the appropriate matrix. To synthesize a program, it's enough to synthesize the matrix of the appropriate connectivity weights. The cornerstone of this approach is the notion of linear streams. Neural networks process streams of numbers. Data flow matrix machines process linear streams. So what is a linear stream? Streams are sequences, and linear streams as such sequences for which the notion of linear combination is well defined. For example, consider vector space and streams of its element form a space of linear streams. Now let's look at the examples of various linear streams. To distinguish between different spaces of linear streams, we'll talk about their kinds. So every vector space gives rise to a different kind of linear streams, streams of vectors from that particular space. A measurable space gives rise to the space of streams of probabilistic samples drawn from that space. Streams of images resulting in animations, streams of matrices, streams of multidimensional arrays, and most importantly for us, streams of vector-like values based on nested dictionaries, which we'll talk about in more details later. Now we are going to speak about neural models of computation. The essence of neural models is that linear and nonlinear transformations of data are interleaved. For example, the recurrent neural network is an engine with a two-stroke cycle, repeated indefinitely. On the down movement, a linear transformation happens using the network matrix W. And on the up movement, neuron activation functions apply generally nonlinear transformations to the inputs of the neurons. One gets the ability to flexibly control the network by only changing its linear part, the matrix, while keeping the nonlinear part fixed. The presence of nonlinear part provides the expressive power. This is the model we use for data flow matrix machines as well. So, data flow matrix machine will be a continuous network with finite active part at any given moment of time. And speaking in terms of matrices, it will be a countable sized matrix. But at any given moment of time, only finite number of its elements will be non-zero. Instead of streams of numbers, various linear streams will flow along the wires. And neurons can have multiple inputs and outputs, so that, for example, we can implement a neuron performing multiplication. So on the down movement, each input which has a non-zero matrix row associated with it gets recomputed as a linear combination of network outputs. And on the up movement, each active neuron, that is, each neuron which has a non-zero weight associated with one of its inputs or outputs applies its activation function to its inputs, producing new outputs. So we have to keep track of input and output arities, and also we have to impose a type correctness condition that non-zero matrix elements are only allowed to connect wires carrying the same kind of linear strings. This is a bit annoying that we need to do all this. So we introduce a linear streams of vector-like values based on nested dictionaries, and that will be sufficiently powerful that you can build data flow machine, matrix machines along a single kind of linear stream. So you don't need to worry about type correctness condition after that. And moreover, as an added benefit, this particular kind of linear streams allows us to define variadic neurons with flexible number of inputs and outputs. So we wouldn't need to keep track of the input and output arities either. So, speaking in terms of vector space of nested dictionaries, Lisp introduced nested lists as expressions, but the hardware was very weak. If the hardware back then was stronger, they might have chosen nested dictionaries instead, which are more flexible but takes more demanding hardware wise. And it is easy to build vector space out of them. The easiest way is to require that all atoms are numbers. And we call the nested dictionaries with numerical atoms V values. And the more general construction exists, see the companion paper for it. So consider ordinary words to be letters of a countable super alphabet. And then look at the following equivalent ways to understand V values. Finite linear combinations of finite strings of letters from the super alphabet. Finite prefix trees with numerical leaves. Sparse tensors of mixed trunk. And then recurrent maps, where a V value is a pair of a number and a map from labels to other V values. And now we'll look at the examples to see what this all means. As an example, we look at this particular tree. And this tree is a linear combination of an empty string, a string consisting of one letter foo, a string consisting of two letters foo and bar, and a string consisting of three letters. Now, think about this as a prefix tree, then it's a linear combination of paths from root to the leaves. Now we are going to talk about thinking about this as mixed trunk tensors. So what is it? It is a scalar 3.5 and a sparse one-dimensional array with the element labeled by foo and the value 2, and a sparse matrix with the only non-zero element sitting at the row labeled foo, a column labeled bar, and that's equal to 7. And there is also a three-dimensional sparse array with one element non-zero. So altogether, it's a sparse array of mixed number of dimensions. Since machine learning field nowadays tends to call multidimensional arrays tensors, we can think about this as tensors of mixed trunk. Now, finally, the most important representation by nested dictionaries. To fold the number into the dictionary labeling, mapping labels to the values, we introduce a reserved element, which is not a part of our super alphabet, and use it as a key to fold the numbers into dictionaries if necessary. Also, the presence of this representation allows us to fold multiple V values into a single V value. Say variable foo is mapped into this V value, and variable bus here mapped into this V value, and they all are part of a single one. And so now we make the model of data flow matrix machines based on this new representation. So here, each input argument is folded into a single V value, and each output argument is folded into a single V value. So activation function of neurons just take a single V value on up movement and produces a single v value, and it deals with the arguments the way it fits. If it wants to multiply two arguments together, it's up to the activation function to do that. And on the down movement, each input which has a non-zero matrix row is computed as a linear combination of all outputs of the network sitting here. The matrix, when you do it this way, acquires multiple indexes instead of just two indexes, so it's becoming a multidimensional tensor. I'm afraid, because time is short, you have to see the companion paper for more details of this. Now, the question is what you can do with this formalism. With powerful enough variadic neurons and streams of v-values, now you can, for example, use single neurons as layers or modules, and so you can have very compact networks accomplishing a variety of tasks. So I'm only going to talk lightly about all this because we don't have too much time. See the companion paper for more details. For example, v-values can include sparse vectors of high or infinite dimension, and so a single neuron can process, therefore, vectors of high dimension or even infinite. Say a neuron wants to accumulate count of words in a given text. The dictionary mapping words to their respective counts is an infinite dimensional vector with a finite number of non-zero elements. So we don't need a neuron for each coordinate of our vector space, which is convenient. Another thing is, with having nested dictionaries, you can easily implement various data structures as nested dictionaries. And actually, the good architecture in this case is to work with immutable data sharing common substructures and garbage collecting obsolete parts. The experience of functional programming shows that this approach is efficient in general and allows easy parallelization. That's what we use in our implementation, and so that's our recommendation in terms of how to use this architecture for programming. The final topic I want to touch is self-referential facilities. It is easy to represent the network matrix as a v-value. So we can designate a neuron which will emit the stream of matrices which we'll use as network matrices. So we'll use the latest version of the matrix obtained on the latest up movement as the network matrix during the next down movement. And so this mechanism allows any data flow matrix machine network to modify its own topology and weights while it is running. And so that's fairly important. And this is something which theoretically traditional scalar-based neural nets can do, but practically you can't really use it. It's too difficult. This facility comes naturally. Our current implementation uses self, which works as an accumulator. It accumulates the network the additive updates from other neurons. And in turn, other neurons can use self-outputs to become aware of the current network configuration. And our experiments show that this mechanism, together with simple constant update neurons, are capable of producing waves of connectivity patterns propagating within the network matrix. So, applications, we do hope that this will allow us to implement in particular various scenarios when network is learning to learn better. We hope that this will be useful for program synthesis and more. There are two electronic resources I want to share, and the companion paper and also the video of this talk will be linked in the next couple of weeks from these pages. Thanks for your attention, and I want to conclude by congratulating Laszlo and Andrzej again. Thank you very much.